And now, the Lowe Post.
Welcome to the Lowe Post podcast, live from my living room in Long Island City, Queens, because I sure as hell ain't going anywhere. And even in these strange, difficult, stressful, and anxious times, it is appropriate and needed to say the three most anticipated words in niche basketball podcasting. What up, Beck?
Oh, what up, Zach? It's good that we can still have these rituals, these really essential, important rituals in our lives, despite pandemics and overall just general weirdness. But I can't remember the last time we did a podcast where we weren't in the same room. So, I'm live from Carroll Gardens. You're live from Long Island City. And it's just not the same as being in your fun little studios at ESPN.
No, I've gone all in the last 18 months on in-person podcasting. I've ditched all remotes except for maybe Arnovitz and Windhorse because we've done so many episodes together. But now we have no choice. We're a borough away. I went to the grocery store today, and I got a lot of items. And like, it's really toilet paper, pasta, and meat. That was all that was not there. Everything else is there. But this is getting scary. It's an uneasy time, obviously, for everybody. And it's quite a weird sensation. I wonder if you feel any of this, to sort of feel like, you know, you and I have worked a long time, put a lot of our life into making it in a competitive business. And you have these moments where, you know, you're standing on the court before a game and you're talking to a player or a coach, or you're at the finals and you have these moments of appreciation. Like, wow, it's so cool. And it's such an accomplishment to be here. And you feel as if the NBA is this indispensable, you know, stalwart of society. And then in the snap of a finger, people start getting sick. Rudy Gobert tests positive for the coronavirus and the league is gone. And it's not coming back anytime soon. It's not coming back for at least 30 days. That feels optimistic, although we don't know anything. And then everything you do is gone. Now, obviously, we have a story to cover. We're going to have to come up with content in the event that the league is gone for a long time. But you go from feeling accomplished to inessential so fast. And you start thinking about things like, well, what else can I do? I have no skills. I have no, this is all I've done for so long. And the feeling of just like, oh, you thought you had this platform at ESPN or Bleacher Report and it's so cool you cover the NBA. No, actually, you're just a freaking peon and you've accomplished nothing and you're a completely useless part of society and your job is gone for a little while as you know it. Do you feel any of that? It feels very unsettling on like lots and lots of levels, obviously.
Well, I'm feeling okay about it before you just said all that, Zach. Now I feel really insignificant. I mean, it is true. Look, we all feel this in this business, and this isn't just even sports writers. It's kind of all journalists. We always feel like, especially, you know, when we've seen so much, going on in our business in the last 20 years or 10 years and jobs lost and all this, and you always think, if it were you, like, well, what else would I do? What else do I know? I'm not good at anything else. It's that, like, there is always that feeling. And you're right, too, that the NBA, we're immersed in it day in, day out, year after year, and we 90% of the time, probably, we're taking it for granted. It's so cool, it's such a great job thing is something that we hear from other people who don't do it, and it's a healthy reminder that what we do, while sometimes stressful and involves a lot of travel and time away or whatever else, it's a good reminder. And occasionally you look up, like in the midst of the finals, and you go, damn, this is amazing. There's certain moments where it just really hits you again and reminds you how fortunate we are to have these kinds of careers. And right now is one of those times where, yes, it's the absence of it, where it's just so freaking weird. And I don't know what to compare. Like, during the lockout, which is, you know, when you and I think got to know each other, you know, quite a bit more because we were both hanging out in all these hotel lobbies in 2011, that was a strange thing. But we had a daily routine of just lockout stuff to deal with. But it was weird not having basketball for a while and not knowing when it would return. But it didn't have the same ominous feel, of course. You know, it was like, all right, this is just a labor dispute, a really big-ass labor dispute, but they'll resolve it eventually, and we'll all go back to covering NBA games, and they'll be fine. This is, I mean, this too shall pass,
right? Well, it's not a sports story. Like that's I was talking to a GM last night, and we were talking about how you know March Madness this and the Masters that and you know the Big East tournament and how ridiculous that the Big East played a half of basketball before realizing we should probably not do that at Madison Square Garden for a little while. And yeah, all of these things are, you know, it's like we're going to miss our sports, and the seniors are upset they didn't get to play the tournament. But like, this is not a sports story. Obviously, this is a global pandemic, and like all people need to be doing right now is figuring out what the best thing for them to do is to help the hospital system not be overwhelmed. And like, I got back from the Sloan Conference on Monday afternoon after having attended Celtics Thunder on Sunday and Celtics Jazz on Friday, which we will talk about. And I have left the apartment, I think, two times since then to do essential errands. And that's all I'm like, everyone is telling you the only thing you can do to help is to keep away from other human beings. So I'm keeping away from other human beings.
It is a helpless feeling, right? If all we can do is sequester ourselves and try to minimize contact so that, you know, even if we're not infected, so that we don't become infected, so that we don't unknowingly pass it on, even if we happen to be infected but didn't know it yet. Like, there's all these things, you know, there's very little we can do aside from just withdraw, which feels like it just makes it even stranger. I've left the house, I think, once in the last 2 days. That was to buy a bunch of wine.
Yeah, we stocked up on that. We stocked up on that as well. I have a question for you as a New Yorker. Are your friends that have the means or an empty house in the suburbs or a place to go that's not New York, are they starting to flee? Because some of mine are.
I haven't heard from anybody doing that yet, but I haven't really checked in. I mean, we have some neighbors here in this building who actually are just moving in, but they also have a place like out on Shelter Island and are probably going to go there for a while because I think their kids' school might be out right now anyway. I think there's if you can get away and you can go somewhere with even fewer people, maybe that's a good idea. We don't have that option.
So let's talk a little bit about the NBA. The league is getting, the league's getting a lot of criticism for waiting until their hand was forced to suspend the season. And obviously it was forced by the Gobert positive test and the just absolutely insane events that happened in Oklahoma City about 48 hours ago before the Jazz Thunder game. And, you know, I get that. I mean, the sense you got from every team, I think you probably heard the same, was we're just kind of waiting to see what the government or the governing authority of our state or whatever tells us to do. And yeah, there were some teams that flew in the face of that, like the Warriors and I think the Wizards, and that's ridiculous and they shouldn't have done that. But at the same time, like, I was at games. I was at the Sloan Conference. Like, this whole big business mechanism that we all work in, like, I don't really feel super appropriate. Like, oh, the NBA was prioritizing money. Shame on them. Yeah, they were too slow, probably. But, like, so was I. I was at the games. I was doing my job. I was trying to dig up some good stories to tell on ESPN, which is owned by the Disney Corporation. Like, if the NBA was taking it lightly, if you were at a game, you were taking it lightly. If you were at a conference like I was, you were taking it lightly. And by the way, we knew we were. A lot of us had discussions about, should we go to this conference? Should we be going to this game? Why are we here? And like, so I feel like it's a little bit of throwing stones from inside the glass house or whatever the hell the expression is. My brain is a little addled. Like, I got that wrong. So like, yeah, I mean, like, we're all like, I like, sure, it's not my decision to stop the league or not, but what I could control, I did not control appropriately. And like, I was just as selfish for going to those games and going to those conferences as anyone else.
Yeah. It's interesting. So I had Mark Lazary, co-owner of the Milwaukee Bucks, on my podcast yesterday afternoon, a little while after the Board of Governors had their conference call. And as we're discussing this, and I'm asking about some of these issues about timing and appropriate measures and when and what was considered, and he said at one point, you know, if a week ago we'd been talking about any of this, it would have seemed outlandish that we were doing all these things, not just that the NBA was shutting down, but that the tournament, everything. He's right. He's right. A week ago, people would have said, you're overreacting. This is crazy. In fact, people were saying it was overreacting even to be discussing the possibility of it or to be having games without fans or anything else. And we had very loud voices at times saying, everyone's overreacting. It's just the flu. Like, you know, I'm not going to go down the political road on this one. But there were plenty of people who would have thought it was absolutely insane and an overreaction. to shut down. So yes, now after the fact, I think it's fair, Zach. I think it's fair to note, especially in light of people praising the NBA for being leaders on this.
No,
the praise is also
saccharine and overmuch. They were playing games. They were playing games until the minute a player tested positive and everyone around said, okay, can't do it anymore.
Yeah, no, not only that, Zach. Not only that, but at the moment that they canceled the Thunder game because of Rudy Gobert's positive test, they were still planning to let the Kings and Pelicans play, and I was sitting there in front of my TV going, how is this even possible? Why is this even a question right now? I understood that they were going to finish out the Knicks-Hawks and other games that were ongoing. Okay, fine. But the second that positive test came in, why was Pelicans-Kings even still on the table? Why did it take so long? Now, again, these are complicated matters. I don't mean to make light of it or oversimplify it. And I'm not – they did the right thing in the end by canceling that one also. But it doesn't make sense to praise the NBA for this because this wasn't proactive. It was reactive. When Rudy Gobert tested positive, they did the only thing they could do. There was no other option at that point. And, yes, they did the right thing, and we can acknowledge that and even say, good job, NBA, for doing the right thing. But they had no choice. Once you quarantine a team and you got to quarantine the team that they just played and the team that team just played and the referees, and it cycles out so quickly that they did the only thing they possibly could have done. And it just so happens that they were the first ones to do it. If this had come up in another league and somebody else had gotten the ball rolling, eventually the NBA probably would have followed suit too. And you're right to bring up also that the Warriors were very grudgingly doing the play with no fans planning because that's not what they wanted to do. And it never came to pass because the season got postponed instead. And the Wizards had, there was a directive, not a law, not an absolute ban, but a directive from the health officials in Washington, D.C. We do not want mass gatherings. And the Wizards said, no, we're good. We're still going to have fans. And so the NBA was not really being that proactive. And I get that too, Zach. Like everybody else, like every other business, like Disneyland, nobody was going to do anything until this hit some sort of tipping point, whatever that tipping point was, and until medical experts, public health experts said, folks, we just can't. Everybody's got to shut it down. And until you're told you have to do that, you're not going to do it.
I hope we've all learned already some lessons from this. You know, there's almost no such thing as overreacting once this news starts to break in other countries and you see what's happening. You know, let's talk about Rudy Gobert. I feel for him. He's going to be stigmatized forever for this. He was callous. He took this too lightly. He admitted his mistake in, I thought, a pretty artful way. He obviously feels guilty. He feels embarrassed. You know, Woj was reporting yesterday that there's a rift now between Gobert and the rest of the team. You know, my feel from the Jazz and talking to people there is that I think once everyone takes a deep breath, that will be okay. That's the hope anyway. But, you know, look, we've all done dumb things, and all of us were taking this lightly, and I can tell you that Gobert is not the only player I saw in the last 10 days or 2 weeks who was sort of similarly making light of the threat of this. He wasn't the only one doing that. And it's, you know, I think also it's a response to an anxious, stressful situation. Sometimes people like to make light of it. I mean, obviously this is – and by the way, we don't know if Donovan Mitchell got it from Rudy Gobert. The last I heard was there's no way to know that. There's no way for the Jazz to know that. It could have gone – the other way around, it could be neither gave it to the other. Like, his test just came back first, right?
Yeah, it's important to note that we don't know. We also don't know that Rudy Gobert messing around touching microphones had anything to do with anything. We don't know that he picked it up from the microphones or that he gave it to the microphones and that the microphones gave it to anyone else. It's not something that he should have done. It was silly. It was callous. It's not setting the right example. But we don't know that him screwing around with it. Now, the other reports were about being callous or careless as well in team settings, and that's a little troubling. But that said, to your point, Zach, you and I were at the same Sloan convention in Boston, and if I came down with the coronavirus coming out of there, then people could say, how callous and stupid were you? You knew this was going on. You decided to put yourself in a room and in a convention center full of thousands of people in close contact with each other. Sure, you elbow bumped a few times, Beck, but I saw you shaking some people's hands too. What were you thinking? Like, we all took it probably a little bit too lightly in varying degrees. Maybe we weren't as cavalier or silly about it as Gobert was publicly, but you know, we've all probably not been taking it seriously enough. And again, part of the problem is that when there are actually influential people in this country, elected leaders even, saying it's no big deal, it's just like the flu, everybody continue as normal, no big deal. What do we expect that some people are going to internalize that and think, ah, it's just overreacting. I don't want to make too much of this. I mean, Rudy Gobert should not be demonized for this. Nothing that he did publicly is an indication that he either contracted or gave the virus as a result of his actions. And yeah, we don't know where he got it, where Donovan Mitchell got it. They could have been from different places. I also don't have, this is a different tangent, but I also am not sympathetic to this view that their privacy rights were somehow violated by their names being reported out. People need to know. Players are in contact with a lot of people that are not just teammates and team staff. They go to community events. They high-five fans in the arena. There's all kinds of folks that they could have come in contact with, and I think people needed to know that. They're public figures. So
having talked to the players' union here and there over the last 48 hours, I can tell you that, yes, there are privacy concerns. But I think that there's also an understanding that players have an interest in knowing what other players have tested positive for this. And I guess, as you're saying, perhaps fans who interact with them do too. And I think what the real concern seems to be is players want to have control over how and when any testing information about them is disseminated publicly. And, you know, in theory, yes, it's possible for the entire player community to sort of keep each other in touch about test results without it leaking to the media. But in reality, I actually don't really think that's possible. So like these test results are going to get out. I think it's more the means and methodology that the union is sort of just, let's keep an eye on it. Let's watch it. Now, my personal Rudy Gobert story is I was at Celtics Jazz on Friday in Boston. That was the first day of the Sloan Conference. And if that was the evening game, nice game, Celtics Jazz, good road win for the Jazz. Remember when like the basketball like was mattered and we're like, oh, the Jazz having a weird roller coaster season. And I know Rudy. I've had Rudy Gobert on this podcast before. So after the game, went into the Jazz locker room to say hello to people as I would normally, said hello to a bunch of their officials and coaches and a couple of their players that I know. And I went up to Rudy's locker after he had gotten out of the shower and just said hi. And we exchanged pleasantries for 15 or 20 seconds, as one does with a million people at every NBA game. Seemed like nothing. Didn't think anything of it. Went out for a beer afterwards with a couple folks who were at the game. And then Wednesday night, the Rudy Gobert news breaks and I'm like, huh. And you try to reconstruct the events like a trial lawyer. Like, all right, so did I touch him? I'm not sure, but definitely didn't shake his hand. Had he showered? I think so. How far away was I from him? Okay, about that far. How long was the interaction? 20 seconds? And then I left? Okay, that seems like pretty benign compared to the interactions he's had with lots and lots of other people. But your mind still races, and I have been in my apartment since the moment I got home from Boston. And like, this is just, we're all sort of trying to grapple with this. And by the way, we've all been at games, we've been on planes, we've been at conferences. Like we're going to see where this goes in the next couple weeks. And that takes us to what we really should be talking about, which is, where are we? And so here's where we are. The NBA has stopped. We are recording this on Friday at about 2 p.m. Eastern time. There are no more conference calls scheduled for today. There are no team president's calls, team GM calls, owner calls, as far as I know anyway. I've been told no. That could always change. Everything can change in 5 seconds right now. Teams have a bunch of team activities they can't do until Monday, and the league is going to give an update to everybody on Monday, at which point we'll see what the world looks like. And obviously the league, the games are on hiatus and at least until April 10th or 12th or whatever the exact date is. And then we just don't, like, no one has any idea. The reality is no one has any idea what the world is going to look like in 2 weeks, a month, or anything, when it's going to be realistic, if ever, for the NBA to resume the 2019-20 season. I have no idea what to expect. I know what people are hoping for. I literally have no idea what to expect. Absolutely none.
It's impossible. You know, people have asked me, all any of us can do is say we don't know. We just don't know. Again, when I had Mark Lazary on my podcast yesterday afternoon, and I said, listen, I'm just going to throw a bunch of questions under the overall heading of questions that I need to ask you that I know you probably don't have an answer for, but I'm going to ask them anyway. And it was things like, you know, what could the season look like once it resumes, and when might it resume, and what's the best way forward, and what would the sacrifices be, or the losses be if you couldn't recoup these games? And it's just everything leads back to we just have to wait and see how this thing unfolds and what public health officials are advising us all. And we didn't know this is where we would be even 2 days ago, much less a week ago. And we don't know where we're going to be a week from now, 2 weeks from now, or that 30-day window from now that Adam Silver announced. So it's impossible. I have some thoughts on what the NBA could do in terms of scheduling and what I think makes the most sense to me. But I'm saying it in a bizarre vacuum of not even knowing where the hell we're going to be in 30 days.
Yeah, but, right now we're still at a stage of like the teams are mostly self-quarantining. Obviously, all the scouts have been taken off the road. There is no road anywhere anymore. No. Other teams are getting tested and will get tested. And then we're going to wake up on Monday. There's going to be a call or a number of calls. I mean, the NBA is absolutely inundated right now. I mean, people think the NBA is sitting here thinking, oh, is this an opportunity to look at a schedule where we start on Christmas and compete with baseball in the summer and end it? No, the NBA, that's come up in the logistical sense of, you know, maybe that's a necessity next season because of how far this season is. No one is having these big picture conceptual conversations. The NBA is trying to survive every hour of phone calls and logistical issues we haven't even thought about. Where are players? What's okay to practice? Individual workouts? Can people come in and get treatment? That's happening in some cases. These big picture issues that we're talking about, wouldn't it be interesting? They're not even in that place yet. They're just trying to survive. They're completely underwater right now.
And how could it be anything but that, right? And, you know, look, I think the NBA's got a lot of really, really smart, sophisticated people, and I have no doubt that they are mapping out possibilities, contingencies, all of that. At a time like this, I have no doubt that wherever they're working from, Olympic Tower or home, they're putting a lot of brain power into this. But
by the way, that's not just me speculating that they haven't had these conceptual discussions. I've talked to people who have been on those calls, and they're laughing at the idea that we're like, oh, we're debating Steve Koonin's proposed schedule. No, there's none of that happening on these calls. It's not happening.
No. I think they'll get there eventually during this pause because the immediate crisis and the immediate impact of having to make this dramatic decision will start to feel, you know, the water around that will calm a little bit in the days to come, and then they can start thinking about all the logistics that would come next, potentially, maybe. But the NBA, like everybody else, like all of us, we're just waiting from minute to minute to see what comes next. While you and I have been talking, I've seen a tweet that the Public Teachers Union in New York is calling on the city to close the schools. So by Monday, there might not be any kids in school in New York City, and that will create a whole other level of challenges for all of us, including probably a great many NBA employees.
Your daughter is old enough that she knows better than to interrupt the podcast being recorded at the house of the Casa de Beck. My daughter is storming in like the BBC kids, man. She is coming in. She's going to be on the podcast. She's going to call. She called Rick Carlisle Mr. Poopy on a phone call last year. I tweeted about that or something. I don't remember what the exact thing was. She called him, hey, Mr. Poop. No, it was just Mr. Poop, not Mr. Poopy. It was more formal. It was just Mr. Poop. She's coming in. She's not stopping. You can't stop her. She's 5 years old. She's coming on. Now, we have a friend who's fleeing town who has offered her apartment to us as perhaps a daughter-free podcast location. But, yeah, that's happening. I wonder if this – so the league's gone for a month. The idea that on April 12th we're going to resume practices with an eye on resuming games shortly after that seems in this moment wildly unrealistic. Now, this moment is admittedly – the onset of full-scale panic in the United States. So this is perhaps not the moment to give realistic, or this is the moment where you're most prone to over-emotional responses and predictions and all of that. I get that. I do think there is a scenario, though, perhaps a realistic one when you look at the timelines of how this virus has unfolded in other parts of the world, where the NBA is going to face a choice of the following. We resume this season, and we resume it so late that even if you truncate almost the entire regular season, you're looking at a season that goes so long into the summer, into the traditional offseason, that the following season has to begin almost at Christmas or December or something like that, because you need to have an offseason. You can't just go season, done, season. So that's choice A, a season that extends so far that the next season's calendar is all screwy and late. And choice B is just cancel the season. And I wonder at what point those are really the only two realistic choices you have, and how short you can really go, how many games you can reduce the schedule by and still have what you consider a realistic playoffs and a realistic champion, and squeeze in that scenario A where you start the season next season at a realistic time.
Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. If we want to take the optimistic view, and we're going to wander into like the just field of wild speculation and assumptions that we can't really truly make, but let's make them anyway. If 30 days from now, things have gotten normal-ish, and it's safe for sports and everything else to start up again, and I don't know if that's even realistic, but if that happened in 30 days, to me, the most logical thing is to say that the standings are frozen where they were the other night and start the playoffs as you normally would in mid-April, and nothing else is interrupted then. Now, I already have gotten people on Twitter saying, oh, it's unfair to these teams that were still jockeying for position, and the Pelicans won't get their chance to make the play. Tough. This isn't a time to be quibbling over this stuff. This is like when you had like an entire quarter of bad empty possessions and you know, just terrible offensive execution, and then you blame a couple of referee calls in the fourth quarter. It just happens. You could have done something about it before. You should have won more before. I think if you just froze the standings, and if you could, again, this is a massive if you could start the playoffs as they normally would in mid-April, based on the standings as they exist now, it's like a lockout season. There weren't same number of games played for every team in this case. There are inequities built into it. Tough. It's just a way of salvaging something and having a normal postseason without having to mess with the draft, free agency, summer league, the Olympics, all the other things that are on the calendar after June. If the NBA decides it wants a full 82-game season, or it wants to start pushing things back and rolling into July and August, then yes, it one, impacts next season, as you've pointed out, and two, it screws up all these other things. Plus, there's all the logistics of having to schedule all these arenas at a time that you didn't expect to need them.
Well, that's a point that not enough people have brought up, is that the arena issue, particularly in a place like Los Angeles, which has two NBA teams and an NHL team, and at least the two NBA teams are elite teams, and hosts a gazillion other entertainment things, that's going to be tricky. But again, this is all, you know, this is all TBD at this point. I mean, we don't know, optimistic, pessimistic, somewhere in the middle. We have no idea what scenario is about to play out. I mean, we have some. We can look to the rest of the world for some, but everything is different. I don't know. Kenny Smith, I thought, asked a great question on the Inside the NBA thing with Adam Silver last night, which was like, what is the go signal? How do you know when it's okay? How do you know when it's okay to play with no fans? Like, what's the, and like, there's no good answer to that question.
No, there isn't. And this is why, you know, it's interesting to have these discussions. Oh, what could the NBA do? How could they fix the schedule, or how could they adjust on the fly, or what? But we don't know. We don't know when, what the go signal is, what constitutes safe, what constitutes rational and reasonable now, and who is that going to come from? And, you know, the NBA will lean on its medical professionals and on elected leaders, and we'll see. But there's no good answers for any of this right now.
Well, one answer that can't happen, in my view, is whatever happens to this season, if that is an extension of it into the summer and that ends up messing with next season's calendar, you can't treat next season like a lockout season where there are back-to-back-to-backs and you're squeezing games together. That's not fair to the players. I understand that there are revenue issues, but I don't think you want to compound this season by making next season some sort of crazy sprint to as many games as we can possibly get, because we need to salvage that revenue too. I think you need to be careful doing that. But again, that's a problem for another year, another month. I don't even know. We could even see, we could see anything, but I'm just saying, like, if it really comes down to time, we can do best of five in at least one sure. or two rounds of the playoffs. Like, any of that's going to be on the table. The table's quite big. The table's going to fit a lot of ideas right now.
Well, as you know, I'm a big proponent of going back to the best of five anyway. It was part of our Drunk with Power podcast last July. And listen, as other people have suggested, since everything is on this big table, the idea of Bill Simmons's entertaining as hell play-in tournament could be on the table. So to my thing about, like, just freeze the standings and then people say, oh, well, that's unfair. Okay, build in enough time for a single elimination tournament involving like the 7 through 10 seeds or something. Like, we could do that. Now the NBA gets to experiment with that. I mean, there's a lot of things that you could do that could be creative that might actually be kind of fun and interesting as a way of coming back out of this. So, yeah, I'd like to see all those things at least discussed.
What's your item at the grocery store that is like a Howard Beck, not luxury item, but just you're very finicky and you have to have this in the house and it's just one of your little creature comforts and you're going to go to the grocery store and get it and you're going to feel funny like poking around amid all of this for like the little creature comfort that I just need in the Beck house. What is it? I'll tell you what mine is after, but what's yours?
Well, there are a couple. They all come from Trader Joe's. and it's going to be actually exact the kind of thing where I haven't done any hoarding yet, but if I got to Trader Joe's today, if I wandered out and I started hoarding all the cheddar popcorn, then it's going to be like, well, I don't know when I'm going to leave again, and I don't know if Trader Joe's is going to restock anytime soon. I'm going to have to ration the cheddar popcorn from Trader Joe's. Also, the not the sugary version, but the naturally dried versions of the Trader Joe's dried mango is spectacular. Also, the Trader Joe's peanut butter filled pretzels. Has this been enough of a promotion for Trader Joe's? I should have a Trader Joe's sponsorship on my podcast by the time this is over.
Well, they've kicked you out of the Park Slope Food Co-op. I assume they have some sort of like ceremony where everyone's holding torches or some eco-friendly version of a torch, and you have been ejected from the Park Slope Food Co-op because you moved. Mine is, I walked into the grocery store today. I'm very embarrassed to tell this story, but you know what? I'm just going to let's bare our souls. There's no reason not to now.
Absolutely.
We need milk. Milk is one of the things that there's sure. always a run on milk. Okay. So we have a milk for our kid, a milk for my wife. You know, everyone likes their different kinds of milk. I happen to like, particularly for my coffee, I've become addicted to soy vanilla milk. I like the vanilla, okay? Don't judge me. So I walk into the grocery store today. I'm like, boy, I really hope they have soy vanilla milk. And then you're like, okay, so I only have so much capacity to carry stuff home. A milk carton's it's a big commitment. It's a big portion of whatever bag capacity you have. Am I going to be embarrassed? Are they going to have it? Am I going to be the only one that gets it? But there was a whole wall of them, so I took one. But I was embarrassed when you go to ring up your stuff at the thing, you know, they're looking at, what does this guy really prioritize? What's really important to this guy's life? And there's soy vanilla milk, a bunch of important stuff like eggs, meats, cheeses, breads, and then a six pack of beer also snuck in. And I wonder, how much is the woman judging me? How embarrassing is it to buy soy vanilla milk? Is it embarrassing? I was a little embarrassed.
I don't think so. I mean, listen, I drink my coffee black, so you know I'm going to judge you just for putting stuff in your coffee at all. But you know, look,
you're a real tough guy over there in Brooklyn.
You're damn straight. I don't want to be one of those. Here's what I would. This would be my embarrassment if I went in and I was the guy who like had like just a massive like 6 foot stack of like toilet paper and that stuff. Like now I'm going to feel like a jerkwad. Like, cause those are the people that are causing problems right now. The people are like hoarding all the Purell and all the soap and all the toilet paper, like just chill people. I understand like these are uncertain times and a lot of things could happen, but Like, my gosh, you know. Now, on the other hand, I may hoard all the cheddar popcorn from Trader Joe's, and I do not want to be judged on that. But, you know, I got priorities.
I'll judge you. I'll judge you on it. What have we not talked about NBA-wise? You said you had some ideas for what could happen. I mean, I just feel like we're so into the unknown, and everyone's thinking about the calendar, what happens to Summer League and free agency. This is all TBD. Like, we have a huge story that's going to unfold in the next month. And it's not a sports story. We have no idea really how it's going to unfold. Again, we can look at modeling. We can look at what's happened in other countries and models based on that. But we don't really know exactly what's going to happen here, particularly in some of these big cities that are the epicenter of the NBA and culture and all of that. There is a universe. I mean, I credit Adam France. Someone had to ask him last night and he answered it. There is a universe where there is no 2019-20 NBA champion. And I think people need to at least get familiar with that idea. Bucks fans, Clippers fans, people who have been waiting for their opportunity like this. I mean, I don't know what percentage chance that is. Maybe it's one, maybe it's 50, maybe it's two, I don't know. But there is a world where obviously there is no 2019-20 NBA champion.
There is. And credit to Adam for answering that honestly when it was brought up on TNT last night, where he basically said, I can't rule it out that there might not be a season. Because that's the honest truth. Nobody can guarantee anything right now. And, you know, when I wrote about this the other night after this all started, you know, went into effect, I just said, you know, the historians are going to have to get their asterisks ready. And doesn't mean that they're going to be essential, the asterisks, but we might. We might need them. This might be a season that has no champion. What was it, the 1994 baseball season where the strike ended the season prematurely? And,
yes.
You know, people were on record-setting paces for whatever at that time. So I think somebody was on, like, the home run record pace at that time. And
somebody was trying to hit 400, I feel like. I think someone
that
was sniffing around 400.
Yeah, I think 400. That was on the table. Probably Tony Gwynn. But we may have that. And you can, you know, you can let your mind start to wander with this where, you know, and again, I talked about this with Lazary yesterday, like the Bucks are having what could be their best season ever. And now it's on hold and you don't know whether that season will ever come to a conclusion and whether you might have a true chance to win a championship and what that might do for Giannis and will he get his second MVP? And if they call off the season, will we still get ballots? Will we still vote on all this stuff? Like, I don't know.
I think we will vote. I think at the very least there will be NBA awards given out. I mean, we've played 60 games. That's a representative season. There will be awards given out. I feel confident in that. But I can't stress enough, like, you talk to people all over the league. Like, yes, everyone is planning all of these contingencies and thinking and wondering and building structures. But the degree to which after doing that for 2 hours, people just throw their hands up in the air and say, we don't know. I mean, is there even a point to all this work we just did? I mean, that's what somebody said to me the other day. We're sitting here doing all this work. Is there even a point to it? We don't know. Like, you just don't know. And you can guess and speculate. It's just a very strange sensation. You just don't know.
It is. It is. And, you know, if the season never starts again, was this LeBron's last chance for a championship? You know, I mean, the way he's playing, you figure he's maybe have another couple of years. But, you know, again, every season is its own thing, and you never know when a superstar is all of a sudden going to drop a notch or two and when it's the end. And, you know, if this season does not resume, we're going to have a lot of those questions. And it has implications, I think, for free agency and, you know, roster building beyond that. It has obviously implications for the salary cap because of lost revenue. There's just so many strands of this, and we don't have any good answers. The one I'm curious about, and I wonder if you've heard anything along these lines, because it feels like between what Mark Cuban said on TV yesterday, what Adam Silver said on this, and what Mark Lazary said to me, it does really sound like they have had at least some discussions about the idea of playing into the summer, which means overlapping with the presumably still going Olympics because Japan is still insisting there's no chance and the IOC is insisting there's no chance of calling it off. But what happens to the Team USA roster if the conference finals or something are being played in July?
For sure they've had discussions about playing into the summer because there is no other choice. The finals already go till June 20th in a long final series. So, like, if you're even delaying the season 3 weeks, right? If you're even delaying the season 3 weeks, or now maybe you can make up some of the delay by cutting
but
games.
But I'm saying in my scenario that I was promoting earlier was the idea that if somehow we get to 30 days and you can just start with the playoffs then and you're still on the normal schedule, boom, first round in mid-April, and then you just go on through. You could still finish in time. It's only if they decide that either this thing drags out even longer or they insist on getting in 82 games, that's when you are now into July,
sure,
August.
But my only point was like, yes, of course they've had these discussions. They've tried to map out many different things. Of course, one of the things they've mapped out is interfering with the Olympics and what happens to Team USA. Probably we send not our A team in that scenario, and we just – that's so fine. We don't send our A team. I mean, our A team is borderline unbeatable, so maybe the Olympics are more compelling. Maybe the Olympics don't happen. I have no – as you said, who the hell knows? But I don't think – I think the consensus so far of all these conference calls that have happened is the hope and plan A is salvage whatever of the season we can, and to not to hell with everything else, but whatever ripple effects of that are on the calendar, including the Olympics, we will live with them because it's more important or more optimal for us to salvage the season and whatever we can salvage of it. If that ends up being possible, even if it takes us into August or whatever it is, I think that's plan A. That's, I would say, people came away from those conference calls, team officials came away from those conference calls expecting, the league to prioritize that and move in that direction if it's all possible. Like if you gave all these people money to bet on, to wager on a scenario, I think the most commonly wagered upon scenario would be an NBA season that ends in late July or something like that. I think that would be the thing that is bet on. And yeah, by that time, the Olympics are already started. They lit the torch a couple of days ago somewhere in Greece, right? Don't they light it in Greece every year? The torch is running somewhere.
I don't know if that's advisable at this time, but, I thought I read they lit the torch. I hope the runners are Purelling as they hand it off.
Well, you can't find Purell, man. I went to Duane Reade the other day and just, I looked around. I couldn't find it. A woman was clearly, a woman who worked there clearly saw a clueless idiot looking around. It was like, sir, can I help you? And I said, well, and I like whispered as if I was asking for illicit drugs. I was like, do you have any, you know, hand sanitizer? And she didn't reply with words. She waved her hand, like, come with me. And I was like, oh, okay. And she reached behind the counter and she wordlessly gave me two, said, we're only giving everybody two. We just got a delivery. And I said, okay. And then I called my wife and I said, hey, Duane Reade has hand sanitizer, go. And she came, it was already gone. They had already given it all away.
We have no hope as a society.
Well, what's one thing you want to binge? What's your number one binge goal, if you have a binge goal?
No, I do. We fell behind on a bunch of things, and we never got on the Succession train. And people were raving about Succession. And I love Billions, of course. And people said, oh, if you love Billions, you're going to love Succession. And it was one of those things. We missed the window. So I do want to cue that up. I want, you know, the latest season. You and I talked about on my podcast a while back, Homeland. Homeland has started the new season, but I haven't gotten to watch any of that yet. So that's on the docket, I think. Yeah. What you got?
Well, I highly recommend Succession. It's a good call. And you're getting it in. To me, the binge sweet spot is like when a show is like 25 episodes in or some manageable number and everyone agrees that it's really good and you can binge it and then catch up and enjoy it in real time with the rest of us. That is the binge sweet spot. I don't know that we have a show like Billions I might do. People seem to like Billions. I've seen a few episodes on a plane. That seems like a good Venn diagram spouse friendly show. It's more like I gotta see I haven't seen any of the movies. Like I gotta see Parasite. I gotta see this Knives Out. Everybody is raving about. I gotta see Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I gotta see I'm so movie illiterate at this point that this is gonna be the goal.
Parasite was amazing. Parasite was absolutely amazing. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and I'm going to get killed for this. I didn't get it. I thought it was slow and kind of weird, and it had its moments, but it didn't work for me.
Well, so I have an embarrassing Once Upon a Time in Hollywood story, which is I was in L.A. the week of the Kobe Memorial, and I think Wednesday night of that week there were no games. And I asked seven people, hey, are you around to get dinner? Nobody was around to get dinner. So I said, all right, I got a night in my hotel room. I did my due diligence trying to make the most out of these hours. And let me rent Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. But it was 9:30 Pacific by the time I started watching. I had watched a couple of NBA games, taken care of some work, filed something, maybe my 10 things column. By the way, I have half a 10 things column that was supposed to run today. I have wrote half of it. I was very much ahead of schedule on my 10 things I like and don't like. Cleveland Cavaliers playing three big men at the same time. That's a like. I gave Torian Prince a dislike. I have all my likes ready to go. And so I started Once Upon a Time in Hollywood at 11:30, 2 hours in, I was getting sleepy. And I knew enough to know that the last 30 to 40 minutes was going to transition into something a little more lively, let's say. And I didn't want to be half awake while watching that. And so I still have to watch the last 30 minutes. That was 2 weeks ago. Still have to watch the last. That was 2 weeks ago when, by the way, 2 weeks ago, February 24th was the Kobe Memorial. We were all there. You were there, right? I think I saw you there.
No, I did not. Anyway,
well, that's not long ago. I got on two cross-country flights that week. That was probably stupid, too. What's one thing that you would advise younger people to binge? Give the 20-something something to binge that they haven't binged yet.
Ooh.
from our generation. Ooh. Although you're older than me, I'm going to give you credit for being in my generation.
There's a distance between us. Something to binge from my youth. Like, I could think, like, there's movies. Like, we have been slowly torturing my daughter with all of our 80s movies. Like, we did Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and we did Stand By Me. And I want to break out Breakfast Club at some point for her. You know, I got to introduce my daughter to all the 80s stuff. But in terms of, like, a series, oh, man. If you want something really kitschy from the 80s, I'm a sci-fi dork. So like Buck Rogers from the 80s is just absolutely bizarrely just so out there. Like but I loved that show when I was a kid. The original Battlestar Galactica. I don't know why I'm going straight
to
like
you're a nerd. I didn't realize you look like a nerd. I guess I should have guessed it, but I didn't realize.
Is it not obvious enough? Have I not like just projected that for my entire, you know, life? I mean, I feel like that should be pretty clear. You know what I never did watch when I was a kid? Because I wasn't that... I don't know why I didn't watch it. But like the legendary basketball TV show, The White Shadow, I should probably go pull that up at some point, because that's one that like people of my generation swear by.
This is going to get me an angry phone call from my old boss. I also have not seen The White Shadow.
Yeah, and Bill's huge on that, right?
That's what I'm saying. I think he has a poster of it in his office in Los Angeles. So that's going to get me some angry emails or angry texts.
Yeah, that one just slipped by me at the time.
I'm going to tell the young people, Simpsons 91 to 95. Look, I haven't seen every show on television. There's not even shows on television. Television barely exists anymore. There's shows everywhere, and they're all amazing, and there's 500 of them. But Simpsons 91 to 95 is still the best television show, in my opinion, that has ever existed on planet Earth. Best show, period, not best comedy. And I happened to be working out a couple of days ago, and there was an old episode on where Lisa exposes Jebediah Springfield, the founder of Springfield, as a fraud. And it's from that era, and it held up very well. I'm very confident that all those Golden Age Simpson episodes that the Lopez brothers are always talking about, those hold up over time. So I'm going to go 91 to 95 Simpsons. If you haven't seen that and you like comedy that was groundbreaking and et cetera at the time, that's my advice.
I would also, just as long as we're going back a ways, and The Simpsons, you cannot go wrong with The Simpsons, I think. I'm sure you're like more of a Simpsons aficionado. You know, like, which eras are the best. Like, I don't have that recall, and I'm not that steeped in it. But I think you cannot go wrong with The Simpsons, period, from any time. But if we're going back to, like, the best series of all time that, like, if you just missed it because it's generationally or whatever else, like, MASH is one of the great all-time TV sitcoms, and it's much more than a sitcom. And Cheers, like, was just, I don't know, I don't want to say groundbreaking for the time, but, like, Cheers was just something completely new when it came to TV. Oh, you know what my other all-time favorite, speaking of the 90s, is Northern Exposure. Did you know Northern Exposure?
I knew of it. I never saw it. I know what it
phenomenal
is.
Phenomenal series.
We have some more time now until we figure out when the league comes back. And again, there are a million unanswered questions. You brought up the cap before. It's the last thing on anyone's mind. But if the cap drops severely this summer, that will impact lots and lots of things. And people have already inside the league, not inside the league office necessarily, but inside the league itself, have already brought up the idea of smoothing any sort of decrease over multiple years. And I thought, boy, I wonder where we've heard smoothing before. And I remember that there was a giant cap spike in the summer of 2016, and people about a year and a half out when we could see that coming because of the new national TV deal thought, boy, it seems dangerous to have a cap spike that big in 1 year. Like some bad things, some anti-competitive things could happen because of that. Maybe we should smooth that in over multiple years. And for whatever reason, it did not happen. And Kevin Durant left Oklahoma City and signed with the Warriors.
The union didn't want to.
And
union opposed it.
I would just like to be in a room with the top Oklahoma City Thunder officials. If there's a reverse spike, a drip, a trough so severe that it ends up being smoothed over multiple years when the spike was not. I just would like to be in the room. That's all. I just want to see what the reaction would be in Oklahoma City if this time everyone was like, you know what, smooth, absolutely smooth it out, smooth as a Zamboni's cleaned ice rink. Let's smooth it out. Anyway.
Sampras might just start smashing things.
I'm glad to hear you're holding up over there in Brooklyn, and on a serious note, this is all very scary and very unsettling. I just hope everyone, the NBA is this wonderful little community we live in and fans love it, and we make a living talking about it and writing about it, and we have listeners and readers and all of that. I just hope everyone stays safe and do whatever the health experts say you should do. Stay inside, social distance, all of that. And I just fingers crossed everyone stays safe and we can return to normalcy sometime soon. But we will, to the degree that this is technologically possible, we will be doing these sorts of podcasts and being in touch. But everyone just stay safe, and that includes you and yours also, Mr. Beck.
You too, Zach. Amen to everything you just said. Everybody be safe out there. Try to stay home. Wash your hands. Be careful. Hopefully this all passes soon. We can get back to normal, whatever normal will be soon. And, in the meantime, we'll all still be podcasting and writing and trying to keep everybody engaged. But, and if all else fails, Simpsons.
Thank you, Howard. Be well. I'll see you down the road. And listen to the full 48 with Mark Lasry. That's up now. And I will presumably be talking to you soon, my friend. Thank you.
You too, Zach. Thank you, man.